Oh, okay, good, good, good.
That's a blessing.
Yeah, they talked about it last night, so that'd, that'd be a blessing. Yeah. That'd be wonderful.
Oh, we see. Yeah. Good.
So we'll just do two.
Okay, good. Will we all get there?
Yep.
That's what I got.
We're ready to do more, brother. We're ready to go with him.
Amen.
Hoping we got a few still running late. I knew we'd be a thinner crowd tonight, but I hope a few of them just running late tonight.
Yeah, I hope so. They'll come on in.
Sister Carol is.
Yeah. Well, good to see y'all. Welcome. Glad to be here tonight. I am to meet with y'all as we begin tonight. Let's all grab a hymnal and let's look together on 501. 501 as we stand together. Sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow nor a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Jim. You may be seated. Thank you for being here tonight. I'm certainly looking forward to that day, either by way of the rapture, being able to see the Lord, or just even if it's by death, that's fine to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord, and that's what we're looking forward to, being present one day with him, and I know you are as well as a child of God. Well, I knew we'd have a thinner crowd tonight. I'm hoping maybe some of our folks are running late. I'm pretty sure probably Sister Carol's running late tonight. She goes almost the furthest drive, but you be in prayer for the service tonight. Lord, might bless us and help us and meet with us. We've already got a call from two folks. The Owens family is not going to be with us tonight. Brother Travis, Miss Amber, she's not feeling well today. She'd had a good week all week, but then today she woke up not feeling well. So be in prayer for her. And then I did get a report from Sister Linda. Said I meant to call her today. Sister Crawford, she had missed on Sunday and hadn't been able to come to the revival this week. She'd been sick. And she is doing better, but she's still not well enough to get to the meeting today. She doesn't like driving at night at all, but Sister Linda offered to drive her, and I've offered several times to drive her as well, and to bring her to church and bring her home, but she's just not feeling well this week, so pray for her. And then pray for my wife. She's here tonight, but she's had a problem with her stomach today. It's not a virus or anything, just every now and then she has these issues, and today was the day, so pray for her. The Lord might help her. She's here tonight. And I thank the Lord she came on. She wanted to be here and not miss it. But she's had a rough day today. And maybe some of you have had a rough day. This is the last night of our meeting, and we look forward to it. But you know how the devil will still fight you right to the very end. And I'm glad God's grace is sufficient, though, and allowed you to be here tonight. Let's pray and ask God to bless us and help us have His perfect will be done in the service. I have gotten actually a number of reports, people contacting me that have been listening to the services online. We've had a number of folks online, I don't know, 45, 65, depending on which nights that picks us up. And they were able to watch this week, and several good comments and some prayer requests. The Lord knows all of those. I won't go over all of them because there's a number of them, but the Lord knows all those, and pray for those spiritual needs. But it seems like God has been stirring hearts this week through the meeting. I thank God for that. That's what we wanted. We wanted God to stir my heart and other hearts that Lord might help us to draw closer to Him. And I really want to see somebody saved. I've prayed for, we've been praying as church now for months, and God might save somebody. And we don't know. We don't know what God's doing, both in here, and we don't know about yet, and out there. And you preach a message nowadays, so a lot of times you get five times as many people listen to it by way of the airwaves and radio and Facebook and all that, and what's in the service. So you never know. But we're trusting God that He would continue working in hearts and lives tonight. But thank you for being here tonight. Let's just pray and ask God to bless us and help us in the service. Brother James, if you would you open us up with a word of prayer, brother? Do you mind? Yes. Yes, God. Help him, Lord. Please. Yes, God. Please do that. Yes. Yes, Lord. Amen. Amen. All right, we're going to bring Brother Jim back up. He'll tell us what page to turn to. We're going to have to sing out. We've got a smaller crowd tonight. Normally, I'm right in there to try to help you all I can. I picked up this allergy stuff. On the way home last night, I started sneezing. I knew the first sneeze. I knew what it was. I knew it. And so I've had it today. My voice just gets weak when this stuff kicks in. And it's all it is, just allergies and all the pollen in the air. They tell me, Brother Leonard was telling me, I noticed up in New York City, it's so bad you can't hardly see the skyline of all those buildings. And evidently it's on the whole East Coast. I guess it's I don't know what it is. It's just a bunch of smog and pollen and everything else that's hit us. But state of South Carolina's got a warning out about it as well. And so just you got to do work outside. Wear your mask if you need to. You folks, all the breathing disorders and all that. But so we're going to have to tend with this for a little bit, I guess, till the rains come in. All right, Brother Jim, come lead us in our next number if you don't mind.
My Redeemer, and that's found on page 222, as we stand, My Redeemer. I will sing of my Redeemer and His wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross He suffered from the curse to set me free. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer. With His blood He purchased me. On the cross He sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will tell the wondrous story, how my lost He stayed to save. In His boundless love and mercy He the ransom freely gave. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer. With his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will praise my dear Redeemer, his triumphant power I'll tell. How the victory he gave over sin and death and hell. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will sing of my Redeemer and his heavenly love to me. He from death to life hath brought me so far. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer. With his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free.
Amen, amen. All right, let's have a little time of fellowship now and welcome each other.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank the Lord. Good time of fellowship. We're going to go ahead and have ask the men to come. This is your last opportunity now to personally give something to Brother Bane for coming preaching to our heart. So if God's put something on your heart, or if he does right now, just be obedient to him, and we'll have the plate go by, and you can certainly put it in there. Now, of course, after the service, if you have to run out the car or something like that, you can give to him personally. That's fine. I've done that before. Preachers go through a process. When you take up an offering, you're a pastor. I don't know what it is about pastors. We never have cash on us. I do tonight because I planned on it, but a little bit. But we never have cash on us. So what? Just about every preacher I know does the same thing. When they bring their wife, they look over at her, and they know she's got money stored somewhere. She's got it stashed somewhere. And my wife will do it all the time. She'll say, I got a little bit, but I'm going to need this back. So she'll give it to me. I'll put it in the offering plate. But I have checked with my wife. She didn't have anything. I didn't have anything. Nobody had anything. So I'd have to run out the car and write a check. And so I got it to them, but I've had to do that on rare occasions. But that may be your situation tonight, and everybody would understand that if you need to do that after service or something. But if you have the opportunity and the Lord moves on your heart, just put it in the plate right now. So I appreciate Brother Bane all week long preaching to our hearts. Every message was exactly what we needed. I thank the Lord for that. I hope everybody did business with the Lord as they should have. I don't know if that's the case. I hope they have, but you never have the aspirations of everybody getting it all right at one time. Sometimes it's a process, but every now and then God will do it. I mean, God will do it in one service, just everything. That's how Israel's going to turn back to God. It's going to be in a moment. It'll be a moment. Finally, they'll see and they'll believe, and then the nation will be saved, that one-third remnant. So God can do that, but I hope you've got help this week. And so now this is your time to show your appreciation to him. So, Brother Leonard, if you would, please give thanks for the offering. Yes, Lord. Yes, God. Please, Lord. Yes, Lord. Help them, God. Yes, Lord. Amen. Thank you so much for your giving. I'll mention this to you. Let's keep praying. Even after the meeting is over with, let's keep praying that God would help our hearts personally. But the others, we had a list of folks we were praying for our meeting. I had 8 on my personal list at home, folks that are either lost or they're so far away from God, I'm not sure if they even know where they're lost or saved. But I had 8, and none of the 8 came. We tried our best to get them this week, unless they come in late tonight. They haven't come. Now, I do know of 2 of them that have tuned in online, and it might be more of that because I don't know how to pull up all that. My wife knows how to check all those things. I don't know how to do all that, but I know of 2 of them that did tune in, and one of them made a comment. Hadn't been in church in a long time. They made a good comment. So let's just keep praying. This isn't the time to stop praying for these folks. If they're out of church or if they don't know the Lord, if they're lost or if we're not sure where they're at, in their life, just keep praying. Just don't stop praying. Just keep praying. Don't give up on them no more than God gave up on you. Just keep praying for them, and we'll keep asking the Lord to help these folks to get right with him. If they need salvation, pray God would save them. He can do that. But he won't force himself on anybody. They've got to open their eyes and realize they need him more than anything, and then God will move in their life. But let's keep praying. And then don't forget the rest of the service tonight. Don't get me wrong, I'm not closing the service. We've got the rest of this service tonight. I have no idea what God's going to do for us. I have seen that God, many times, God has saved the very best for the last meeting. I've seen it in camp meetings. I've seen it in mission conferences. I've seen it in revival meetings. And it may be that that's what the Lord's done for us tonight. This might be that that night, that what I would call the breakthrough night, where God just really tears down some worldly strongholds and moves in people's lives and changes their lives. That could be it. We pray that that would be the case. But now I'm going to let Brother Jim introduce our special. We got a special tonight, and you'll be happy to hear them tonight. But I'm going to let Brother Jim introduce them, and I'm going to step out of the way while they get ready to come.
So fortunate to get a plate full tonight. Get the dessert too first. But Brother Bane and Caller is going to sing a special for us tonight. So y'all come on. Thank you so much.
Brother, we'll go ahead and sit down. Brother, I'm going to go ahead and sit down. So when you finish, you go ahead and preach to us. So.
All right, I appreciate Coulter being able to come down to the meetings this week. He travels with me more than any of the rest of the family. And me and him have been around the world and back. And he's my left-hand man. I mean, my right-hand man. Sometimes my left-hand man. But he's a blessing. God's given him a special gift and made him a special human being and give him opportunity to be able to travel with me and be part of the ministry. He's got a little book table that he brings to most places and raises funds, and right now he's raising funds for the Philippines. We had Rommel Reeves come over, and he stayed with us 3 months in our prophet's room, and he raised money to build a big building over there in the Philippines, and he went to one of Coulter's special needs baseball games, and he come away from there saying, you know, nobody's doing anything with special needs folk in the Philippines. He watched a blind girl bat. He watched crippled kids go around the bases in a wheelchair and watched Coulter catch. And boy, he's a good catcher. But that little old crippled kid will come across the home plate and Coulter will run out there and tag him, say, "You're out of here." I mean, he takes it serious. But Rommel saw all that, and he said nobody's doing anything with special needs families there. And so they had their first one, and he'd done a survey and told Donnie Jones he had 40 families. He said, "Ha, he thinks he's got 40, he'll have 80. And sure enough, he had 80. And this past time, it's the second time they're doing it every quarter, they had 160 show up. And they had, I think, 40-some saved out of the families and all that the first time, and then had a good number saved this second time. And the Lord's blessing in that. And Coulter's been able to raise the money for that to supply the need. They feed them. They give them new shoes, which is flip-flops, and then some sporting equipment and do some games with them. And then they preach the Word of God to them and then provide chick tracks, and they love those chick tracks and Bibles and different things like that. And God's used Coulter to be a blessing there. And you know, if you want to be a blessing, you want to be a help, it don't matter who you are, there's something you can do if you'll seek the Lord and ask the Lord to use you for His glory. Peter, do you love me? Go and feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Take care of the weak. Peter, do you love me? Stand up and be strong. For now I'll have to go away, but I'll not leave you alone. They took the Lord from the garden. Peter followed them. Someone recognized him, said, "There's one of them." Peter cursed and denied him 3 times in a row. But his heart was broken when he heard the old cock crow. Peter, do you love me? Go and feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Take care of the weak. Peter, do you love me? Stand up and be strong. For now I'll have to go away, but I'll not leave you alone. Well, on the day of Pentecost, the Comforter arrived. He came in as a rushing wind, like cloven tongues of fire. Peter stood up and began to preach to them the holy word. And after 3,000 souls were saved, these words you might have heard. Lord, you know I love you. I'll try to feed your sheep. Lord, you know I love you. I'll take care of the weak. Lord, you know I love you. I'll stand up and be strong. You gave to me the Holy Ghost. Now I'll never be alone. Well, Peter grew stronger in the faith as he preached throughout the land. He walked and talked and he prayed to God, obeying his command. And then one day he met his fate. They say they nailed him upside down. But in my mind I can hear these words as that old hammer rang out loud. Lord, you know I love you. I've tried to feed your sheep. Lord, you know I love you. I took care of the weak. Lord, you know I love you. I've stood up and been strong. I thank you, Lord, for using me. But now I'm ready to come home. Hallelujah. Thank you, Coulter. Amen. All right, I'll ask you tonight, if you will, turn to Psalms chapter number 1, if you will, please. The book of Psalms, chapter number 1. And while you're turning, let me say it's been a real privilege and blessing to be with you here at Victory again. And I am so grateful for Brother Leroy having us in and letting us labor under his ministry in these days in the Word of God. And it's always a blessing to be here and see the faithful folk of this church carrying on and serving the Lord. And we do appreciate you praying for us coming into the meeting. And I know you'll be praying for us as we leave here. Again, on Friday at 12 o'clock, high noon, I'm supposed to be preaching to probably, well, it's going to be 160 young guys that have been in football camp. And they've been ministered to all week long. They've not only learned skills in football, but they have been had devotions in the morning and in the middle of the day as well, and had prayer meetings with them. And then we'll get to come in there for the final service, and they'll have their families in there. And so there'll probably be better than 300, maybe 400 folk that'll be there. And I'm looking forward to that. Pray God to give us liberty and wisdom and clarity, and then the Holy Ghost to bathe that place where there might be good response to the gospel. Brother Austin Harmon, he pastors a small Baptist church there in Georgia, but God put it in his heart, and they gathered these up. And I told Brother Austin, it sure is good to get out of the aquarium and fish in the ocean. We fish in aquariums, but boy, they're reaching folk that are out there in the ocean, and there's so many around us. We just need to get out of our aquarium and get out there in the ocean and go fishing for the glory of God. And then I want to thank you, folk, for your sacrificial love gifts that you've given all week long. And I don't take that for granted. I know what it is to get up early in the morning and work hard all day long and then come to the house of God weary and tired and then give of your substance that you have earned through the week and God's blessed you with. And I don't take that for granted, but I thank God for his people. And that's how God takes care of us down through the years. We've got an old fellow on Green River. He's always gouging my dad. And he'll say, how does Randy go around the world? Who sponsors him? Who takes care of all that? Man, that must cost a lot of money. My daddy said, well, he's got a father that's really rich. Hallelujah. And the Lord does. You never get your eyes on people. You never get your eyes on places. You keep your eyes on the Lord. And the Lord is always faithful, and many times it'll be through the most unusual means that you could imagine. And I could write a book on how God has provided down through the years. And you know, he provides not only for me, but he'll provide for all of his little children, all of his young'uns. He's a good heavenly father. He said, if a man don't take care of his own, he's worse than an infidel and denied the faith. Nobody's going to call God an infidel. He takes care of His children. Amen. And it sure is good to be in His family. All right, let's stand tonight. We'll reverence God's Word together in Psalms chapter number 1. I'll tell you what let's do. Let's have some responsive reading, will you? You read along with me, and let's read this chapter together. It's such an important chapter in the Word of God. Let's us all read it out loud. You read it out loud with me. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Lord, thank you for letting us read this chapter in the Word of God. Thank you, dear God, for this church. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings that's been our portion as we have come to minister the Word of God. And Lord, just like Mary that anointed the feet of Jesus, she got more in her hair than she got on His feet. Lord, I feel like I've got more blessings than we've ever been able to bestow on this congregation. But we bless you and thank you for all your goodness and mercies to us. And now, Lord, we pray in this final service that the Holy Ghost will work and move. Lord, you'd put something down deep in somebody's heart that they'd not get over for time and eternity. Lord, minister not only here, but all those that are out there in the cyber world. God, wherever they're at, they're out there in Arizona or even up in smoky Canada, or Lord, around the world, different places. God, we ask you to bless and move there. Lord, have your will in your way. Save souls, stir your people. Kindle the fires of God within our heart. And Lord, we'll praise you and thank you and bless you for what you do in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I'm preaching tonight on the thought, the blessed man. The blessed man. This is the divine title. Blessed is the man. Now, Alfred Plumer says, what a foundation is to a house and what a keel is to a ship, this psalm is to the rest of the psalms. Matter of fact, in the Hebrew, this is not the first chapter. This is the introduction, and chapter number 2 is the first chapter, because chapter number 1 introduces all the rest of the psalms. And if you go through it and you take your Strong's Concordance or your computer program or whatever, and you look each one of these words up and you run the word through the book of Psalms, you're going to find out that every phrase is repeated somewhere and every thought is dealt with and deliberately expanded and expounded upon throughout the rest of the book of Psalms. And when you read this psalm, it is a psalm that prepares us for the rest of the Psalms, and my, what a blessing it is. Now, this word blessed, it's in the interjectory form in the Hebrew. In other words, a Jew would read it like this. Blessed is the man. I remember Dr. Hughes in Bible College at Tabernacle. He taught English, and one night he was teaching on interjections, and didn't seem like much of anybody was getting it, so he just stopped and said, hey, ho, ha, hey. He said, that's an interjection. It's got an exclamation point. It's something exciting. Well, when you open up, blessed is the man, the Lord's saying, I'm fixing to give you some very exciting material and some material that ought to excite your soul. Now, that word blessed, it means happy. It means, oh, how happy. I hear some preachers, they get all spiritual and say, God's not interested in you being happy. He's interested in you being holy. Well, I have to beg their pardon, because in this very first word of this first psalm, he said, blessed is the man. And the word blessed, just look it up. It means happy. It means, oh, how happy. Matter of fact, God goes on in the Psalms to say, happy is the man that hath the God of Jacob for his refuge. Somebody said, well, happiness depends on happening, but joy is an inward burst of radiant glory. They asked, joy is that? But you know, I can be happy because of happenings, because of what happened to me when I got saved, because of what happened to me today, what's going to happen to me in the future. And if I get to thinking about God's divine happenings in my life, it will make me happy. Hallelujah. And when you think about him being the God of Jacob, Jacob was that Saul of Tarshish of the Old Testament. He was the heel catcher, the beguiler. He was the troublesome son. And yet God said, I'll be the God of Jacob because I'll wrestle with him and pin him down till he confesses his name, and I'll change his name and I'll make an Israel out of him. And whenever we get to thinking about the God of Jacob being our God, that he would love us and care about us and put up with us and minister mercy and be long-suffering toward us, I think we ought to be a happy bunch when we realize how good God has been in order for us to be where we're at tonight. Amen. Yes, it means happy. Oh, how happy. And then the Hebrew would say, there's no such thing as a singular blessing. It's always in the plural. In other words, one blessing begets another blessing. The Bible talks about God daily loading us with benefits. And he speaks of the things that accompany salvation. And my friend, I want to say that when you are blessed of God, it's not just one blessing, but every blessing begets another blessing. And it just goes on and on and on. We sing the old song, count your many blessings, name them one by one. But you're going to run out of numbers before you run out of counting the blessings of Almighty God. It's always in the plural. There's multitudes of his mercy and his good blessings. And then it means to be prospering. You know, God's people are a prospering people. And I know, just like every other truth, the devil boogers God's people up because somebody runs overboard on it. The health and wealth crowd and the nabbit and blabbit crowd robs us of the fact that the Lord prospers his people. And you get saved, you get right with God, you can't help but prosper and be blessed. I stop and get gas. Most of the time I put it on my credit card anymore because I don't even like to go in there because I have to stand in line beside some old boy. And he says, yeah, give me one of those five spots. Yeah, I won $30. Give me another 20 and give me a 15 and one of those Powerballs over there too. And, oh, by the way, I need one of those packs of so-and-so. No, not the long ones, the menthol. No, that one with the filter on it. No, not the green pack, the red pack. I want you to give me one of those. Okay, and then here's my six-pack of beer. And give me $5 worth of gas. And I hear this story over and over and over at these gas stations. And I've often thought, man, here's a guy living like that. And then he gets saved by the grace of God. Well, the Lord takes his booze away from him. And then God wrangles his cigarettes out of his smoke. And then the Lord helps him to quit his gambling. And on the next Friday morning or next Saturday morning, he wakes up and he reaches in his pocket and he said, whoa, where'd that come from? My goodness, I'm being blessed. I'm prospering. And it's just simply because he's got saved and the Lord helps him control his substance and that which he puts in his hand. You can't help but be blessed and prosper when you get right with God and you start taking care of the assets that God has given you. Sin's an expensive thing. You're going to go out and live a life of sin, you better have plenty of money because there won't be any freebies. Just like the prodigal son, when he ran out of money, he ran out of friends, he ran out of pleasure, he ran out of the wine, the women, the song. And when he couldn't pay, they said, out the door you go, old boy. And that's the way the world is. But oh, praise God, God not only saves us by grace, but it's the gift that keeps on giving. Amen. And listen, if you're so broke you can't pay attention, if you're saved, you have the riches of Christ and you prosper and you're richer than the richest man on the face of the earth that knows not God. Hallelujah. Yeah, he said, blessed. Blessed is the man. And then that word blessed, it means to enjoy happiness. Not just to be happy, but to enjoy happiness. We're so blessed, but a lot of times we let the devil get us down and discourage us with all our attitude, and we say, well, look what I got. Look what's happening to me. Look what I'm going through. And you can't even enjoy what God has put in your hand. May the Lord help us not to grumble and growl, but help us just to look around and count our blessings and our many assets that God's given us and enjoy what we've got rather than coveting and looking over the fence and thinking, boy, if I could just have that, I'd be happy. If you can't be content with such things as you have, you're not going to be content with many more things when you do have them. Then that word blessed, it means content, content. Paul said, I've learned in whatsoever state I am to be content. He said, oh, I know how to abound, but I know how to be abased. I know how to have plenty, and I know how to live in poverty. I know how to eat the best that there is to eat, but I know what it is to be on starvation serving God. But I found out that a man that is contented in Jesus will be the most contented man. I heard about a king one time that had a dream, and he dreamed if he could wear the shirt off a contented man's back, he too could be contented. So he conveyed that to his service. They went through the whole kingdom, finally found the man they all said was the most contented man in the whole kingdom. He brought him before the king, and of course they dressed him up and all of that and got him washed up and cleaned up, and the king told him his dream, and he looked at that fellow and he said, sir, can I have the shirt off your back? And the fellow looked at him and said, sir, I don't even own a shirt. Jesus said, it's not in the abundance of the things that a man possesses, but it's in our relationship with the Lord. And when we have a right relationship with Him, we're not governed. And the world does not set our destiny. And they do not govern our happiness and our joy. And you don't let other people dictate to you whether you're sad or happy or whatever. You rise up and go on beyond that. Oh, Paul and Silas was beaten, whipped, and they were lied on, and those pimps had tried to destroy their lives. It seemed like the work of God is going on. And if anybody had a reason to be sad and moping, it was them. But instead, him and old Silas struck up a good song at midnight and began to sing and began to praise God. And you know what? God honored that. Hallelujah. And you know, the Lord word blessed means to enjoy our happiness and to be content with such things that we have. Now, look at this. First of all, in verse number 1, we see the position. Blessed is the man that walketh not. Blessed is the man that standeth not. Blessed is the man that sitteth not. It starts out with repentance. You'll never be blessed unless you're repenting. You notice he says it in the negative, not, nor. And if you're not willing to allow God to put negatives in your life, you're never going to enjoy the positive. But it says, blessed is the man that walketh not, standeth not, sitteth not. He's a man that realizes he cannot go with the world, and he cannot operate like the world and go with God. God's ways are not our ways. God's thoughts are not our thoughts. God's word teaches us that if we're going to go with the Lord, we're going to have to go against the course of the world that we've been swept down in all of our lives, and our lives are going to have to turn around. And if a man doesn't want to change and not willing for God to help him be able to change, he's never going to be blessed of the Lord. And so we see it's in the negative. Number 2, I want you to look at the details of this. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. He starts out with counsel. Then he talks about standing. And then it talks about sitting. Now that's where it always starts out. Counsel of the ungodly. That's what got us in trouble in the first place. The devil said to Eve, yea, hath God said, let me counsel you, Eve. Why, God's a bad God. He's keeping something good from you. He knows the day you eat thereof, you're going to encroach on his knowledge, and you're going to know good from evil. And the devil begins to counsel Eve, and Eve buys the counsel and takes of the fruit and gives to her husband. And Adam and Eve are duped by the counsel of the devil. The devil didn't stop counseling in the Garden of Eden. He's always had a counseling service. And he won't charge you anything to counsel you. He'll counsel you with the newspaper. He'll counsel you with the radio. He'll counsel you with songs. He'll counsel you with friends. He'll counsel you with the ungodly internet. He'll counsel you with all manners and all ways. He's always got a word to insert and something to tell you. But the Lord said, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. So how's he to walk? Well, Jesus is called the Wonderful Counselor, the Prince of Peace, the Everlasting Father. And we get our counsel from our God. We get our counsel from the Word of God. And you have to stop your ears up to the counsels of this world, because they'll counsel you right away from God and out of the will of God. And it's not just the world counseling you. There's a lot of religious folk out there that will counsel you. Boy, it bothers me when men get out of the Bible and they start all this counseling service. And I preached this one time. I said, if you want counseling, you can get all the counseling you need right out of the pulpit from the man of God if you'll just listen. But yet, he's preached the message and then they want to get him aside and talk to him for 2 or 3 hours. And it's the very same thing that he just preached in the pulpit. Now, I had a pastor one time say a man in his church got mad at him and stayed mad at him for over a year. And finally the brother asked him, said, what is your problem? You got a burr in your saddle and I want to know what it is. He said, well, Randy Bane come in there and he said, you can get all the counseling you need right out of the pulpit if you just listen. He said, and you said amen. He said, I took that a young couple couldn't even get counseled for their marriage. He looked at him and said, man, you're a moron. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about if you just listen to what the Word of God's saying, you get plenty of counsel, because this is the good counsel of the Word of God. And there'd been many a preacher messed up by counseling some woman by herself, and her husband's been having trouble, and they have all these issues, and they start dealing with that, and first thing you know, him and hers run off, and they're gone. You got to guard yourself against a lot of stuff. Amen. But blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. They learn to turn a deaf ear and say, no, I'm not doing that. I'm not going that way. I am not going to listen to that counsel. And then secondly, he said, blessed is the man that stands not in the way of sinners. I look at this two ways. First of all, I believe the literal thought is, he doesn't take his stand like a sinner takes his stand. Now, a sinner gets his counsel. And then, in his heart, he says, all right, here's what I'll do. I'll take my stand. I'm not going down there to that church. They're all a bunch of hypocrites. And have you not heard that before? And I've heard them say, well, there's hypocrites in the church. I said, well, there's hypocrites in the manufacturing business. There's hypocrites in the medical field. But you go to the doctor, there's hypocrites in the mechanical business. Man, they'll rip you off, so don't get your car worked on somewhere. And I said, by the way, you can go to church with a few hypocrites, or you can go to hell with all of them. That's your choice. Amen. But a lot of folks say, I'm going to stand here now, and here's my thought. Every preacher, he's just after your money. Every church, they're just after your family. Everybody, they're just, and they start taking that stand. And boy, they get solidified in that moronic counseling that the devil and the world and the flesh gives them. But then thirdly, he says, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. If you listen to the counsel of the devil, then you take your stand with that, then you're going to wind up being a scorner, a belittler, a mocker, one that lower rates the Word of God, the people of God, and the things of God. And the Bible talks much about scorners in the book of Proverbs and how ungodly it is. And they don't believe it, and therefore they talk against it and they mock against it. And that's the way the ungodly. And God said, blessed is the man that does not do that. But you learn to walk in His counsel. You learn to take your stand with Jesus. And then you learn to honor God and glorify God. Instead of using that tongue for scorn, you use it for praise and adoration unto our blessed Lord. And the Lord said, if you want to be blessed, then that should be your position. And you got to get in the right position if you want the blessings to flow. Then in verse number 2, look at the pleasures of the blessed man. Well, there's the not-not-knowers. So what does thrill the heart of the blessed man? What is his pleasure? Well, verse 2 says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Now notice the alternative. He said, but. That's that coordinating conjunction. Everything's turned on its heels. He doesn't delight in gossip and scorn and all of that, but his delight is to get in the Word of God. And I believe that that is a real token that a person is really saved. Peter said, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word that ye may grow thereby. As a little babe desires its mother's milk and its nourishment and it satisfies them, God said that we're to desire the sincere milk of the word of God. Boy, milk provides all kind of vitamins and calcium and all kind of good things. And I know there's a haranguing against milk, but God said Canaan was a land flowing with milk and honey. There must be something in milk. And then I think about this. You go to the barn and you milk old Betsy the cow. And then you go right back that evening and you milk the same cow and get fresh milk out of her. And you do that tomorrow and the next day and the next day and the next day. And when you go to the Word of God, it's not going to cease giving you milk. Hallelujah. Boy, you can get fresh milk from the udders of the Scripture over and over and over again. Somebody said, well, you preached that text before. That's right. I milked that cow before and I'm going to milk her again. And there's no text that does not stand to be repeated. You see, John said, behold, the Lamb of God. Nobody listened. The next day, again, he said, behold, the Lamb of God. Two of his disciples finally got it. Maybe like a young fellow that took that church and he preached on hell Sunday morning. He preached on hell Sunday night. He preached on hell Wednesday night. Old deacon said, hey, brother, you got another message? He said, well, when you do something about this one, I'll give you another one. Amen. And sometimes it bears repeating, but you can get milk out of the Word of God throughout the Scripture, and then that milk can turn into meat as well. Amen. But he said, blessed is the man, but his delight. Now notice his appetite, his delight. Delight is something you're thrilled about, something that you want, something that really turns you on, something that satisfies your soul, something that gives you pleasure. And I ask you this question, does the Word of God give you pleasure? Is it just a book that governs our life, or is it a book that we really enjoy studying and reading and digging in and basking in its promises and letting it exhort and minister to our heart? Don't just take the Bible as some piece of literature. Take it as God's Word that He wants to minister to you and let it be a delightful thing. And then I want you to look at the application. He said his delight is in the law of the Lord. Didn't say under the law of the Lord. There's a difference in being under an automobile and being in an automobile. And that word law of the Lord is used many times for the whole of the writ of the Scripture. Any times in the New Testament talks about as it was written in the law. Well, that wasn't written in the Ten Commandments, nor was it written in the law Moses gave, but it was written in the Old Testament, maybe in some of the prophets and all that. And it's one of those Psalms 119 gives it again and again. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul, and it has to do with the whole writ of the Word of God. Bothers me to hear these Bible dissectors. They cut it all up. And I've even heard one say, independent Baptist preacher say, oh, you can't use 2 Chronicles 7:14 for a verse of revival for today. That was for Solomon's day. That was for Israel. And I just thought, everything in 2 Chronicles 7:14 is repeated in the New Testament epistles. I was sitting in a college classroom. Dr. Seitler was teaching, and for some reason I had this thought in my mind, and I asked him. I said, Dr. Seitler, would Ephesians 2:8-9 be one of those international verses of Scripture that would really be applicable from Genesis to Revelation? He thought a minute, and he said, yes, sir, it sure would. Boy, there's a lot of these verses that are applicable from the beginning all the way through. You see, the Bible says in the volume of the book, singular, it is written of me. And you can find Jesus on every page of the Word of God. You ever seen one of these pictures where it's got maybe 1,000 different little pictures? And then when you back up and look, it's got a picture of one man, and they've used all these little pictures to draw that. Well, you take all these little pictures in the Word of God, and you know what it pictures? It pictures Jesus Christ. Somebody asked me, preacher, what are you? Are you a three-pointer? You a four-pointer? You a five-pointer? I said, why, no, I'm a 66-point Baptist. Amen. I just believe in the whole book. I believe you can preach the gospel out of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st, 2nd Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalm, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and all the prophets. You can preach the gospel through it all because it's one message about Him. It's the hymn book. This Bible's about Him. And boy, to delight ourselves in the whole of the writ of the Word of God. By the way, it is a 66-streamed harp. There are 66 streams, and boy, whenever you learn to play, you got to have harmony. Our sister knows about harmony. She knows about those, there's a lot of strings on that piano, but she's got to put the right strings in the right place. And you know, when the devil tempted Jesus, Jesus laid it to him, it is written. So the devil said, oh, I can play that number. And so the devil said, it is written, the angels will bear thee up, lest thou dash thy foot against the stone. Just go ahead and obey me. And Jesus said, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. I was doing a word-for-word study through the New Testament, just looking the words up. And boy, it's a blessing to know the Word of God. You can go to the words of God. And I started not to even look up that word again, but I touched it. And you know what again means? It means oscillatory repetition. Now, when I was in the third grade, old Miss Irvin, she brought in a tuning fork set. She brought a high C and a low C. And she hit that high C, zing, and the low C started vibrating, zing. We always thought she was witchy, and that proved it to all of us. I mean, she was something else. She'd throw books at you and everything else. She's a roughneck teacher, I'll tell you. But I learned a word there in the third grade called oscillatory repetition. It means to vibrate one against the other. And they tell me when they would build a new harp, they would have an old harp that was in perfect tune in one corner, and the guy'd start tuning his harp in the other corner. And let's say he was plucking a C string. Ding, 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 ding. And when he got to that perfect C, that C in that other harp would start to vibrate over there. And he'd say, oh, that's in tune. Then he'd go to the D and the E and the F and so forth. Oscillatory repetition. And to preach this Bible the way it ought to be preached, it is a book that harmonizes with itself. And you know, a lot of folk get messed up in their doctrine because they don't have oscillatory repetition. And I believe for every true doctrine in the New Testament, there's going to be types and pictures of that in the Old Testament. And one reason I believe in the rapture of the church is because there are two raptures in the Old Testament. One of them is Enoch, who walked with the Lord and he was not. Somebody said, well, he wasn't raptured. Well, read Hebrews chapter number 11. You'll find out that he was translated, and that's our word, rapture. He was caught out of here, and he's caught out of there before the flood. And then there was Noah's day. Whenever the Bible tells us after Noah's day and the judgment, Elijah came along, and before the captivity, God raptured him out in a chariot of fire. Now somebody said, who are the two witnesses? I believe it'll be Enoch and Elijah myself. They both got the message, and boy, you read Enoch's message in Jude, and he sure does lay it on what's happening today, but I wouldn't argue with it over. It don't matter to me. There are going to be two witnesses, and it'll be whoever God wants to be there. But every true doctrine in the New Testament is going to have types in the Old Testament that completely harmonize. And a lot of people get out of harmony in the Word of God because they try to twist and they try to put the square pegs in a round hole and try to make the Bible. Instead of making the Bible, let the Bible speak. Let the Bible just, and you'll find out like Solomon's temple. When it was built, there was neither sound of hammer, saw, nor axe. And the only way you could build a magnificent building like that is for it to all be prefab. Every timber was hewed and every stone was notched. And when it came on the ground, it just dovetailed and fit perfectly together. This Bible is the prefab Word of God. And that's why we have a perfect law, converting the soul, and it dovetails together. And when you start trying to ram things that don't need to be rammed, and you don't let the Bible harmonize, then you're going to get messed up in your doctrine, and you're going to get sidetracked on what God wants you to do. Blessed is the man. He meditates in the law of the Lord day and night. And then that word meditate, it means to ruminate or to chew the cud. Old cow, she chews that fescue. And if you ever chewed fescue, you know that it's sharp and dry. We couldn't chew tobacco when I was a boy. My mama wouldn't let me, so we'd get fescue grass and chew it. But when you got big fescue, that stuff will cut your tongue, and it's dry. But if you keep chewing on it, after a while, that green juice starts flowing. Mama would say, why is your teeth green? God, we'd been spitting fescue tobacco, you know. But old Betsy the cow, she swallows it all down in her belly, and then she lays under the tree, and you'll watch her. She'll go, brrrr, and then she'll start chewing again, and it goes into another stomach. And then that which she has chewed up goes into that stomach, and that stomach is digested. And that grass in the field becomes part of Betsy the cow herself, and God turns it into milk and butter and T-bone steaks. The Bible talks about the engrafted Word of God. And when you study this Bible and you meditate on it, sometimes it's dry. Sometimes you don't get nothing. But you just keep rolling it over and over and over and chew on it. And after a while you say, And it's such a blessing to hear somebody preach. And you say, why didn't I see that? I mean, it's laying right there, and I've read that 1,000 times, and there it is. And boy, what it is that meditation, just chewing it up. And that's why when God's children get Alzheimer's many times, they can't remember their son or daughter or their caregiver's name. My mom got in that shape, but I could start a verse of Scripture, and she'd finish it. And that's because that Word becomes engrafted. It becomes a very part of our lives. Hallelujah. Just keep meditating on it. Now, I'm giving you a whole series of messages, whether you realize it or not. So you listen fast, and I'll preach fast the rest of it, okay? All right, so the position. Number two, the pleasures. Number three, the picture. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, bringeth forth his fruit in his season. There's a picture of the planted tree, and I believe that to be the palm tree. Later on in Psalms 92, it talks about the righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. I did my thesis at Tabernacle on the Phoenix de la Carifa, the palm tree promise. And the Arabs have 360 uses for the palm tree. They got 360 days in their year, and you can find a use for it for every day. And the Bible said the righteous will flourish like the palm tree, and we ought to have a use for every day. And notice this tree is a planted tree. It doesn't just spring up wild. In order to be planted, it had to be possessed by somebody. You don't just plant trees that you don't possess. You have to possess that tree, and then you have to place that tree. God says, my people are possessed people. I own them. They belong to me. And I have planted them. And Brother Ralph Sexton Sr. used to preach, and he wrote a little book on it, Bloom Where You Planted. And it's amazing to see where God plants his people. And then he said it'll be a producing tree and bring forth his fruit in his season. Now you need to get that in his season. Even that date palm tree doesn't bring forth fruit all year long. It has seasons when it brings forth fruit. That's the way it is in churches. You'll go through a winter, spring, summer, and fall around here. As a man of God, sometimes everything is so fruitful. Other times it's cold winter and it's hard, but you just keep on keeping on in those days. But he said in his season, and if you stay with God, you will produce fruit. Old Pastor Brother Raymond Geis used to say, if you abide in the vine, you have to backslide to keep from bringing forth fruit. For Jesus said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, he said, that's where you're going to become fruitful. Because you're drawn of the sap of the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost is going to make you fruitful. And then notice it is a persevering tree. His leaves shall not wither. And whenever hot weather comes, the head of that palm tree gets more green because it acts like a pump, bringing water from the hidden deep resources. Sometimes their roots will go 150 feet down into the ground, but that sun acts like a pump and it pulls it up through the stem into the head, and boy, she gets green. And whenever the wind blows, those old palm leaves go back and forth saying, praise God, praise God. And when Jesus came into Jerusalem, what'd they do? They got palm tree limbs and they began to wave them as he came down the way, saying, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. And friend, whenever the heat gets on, God's people are going to be praising him. And then he's a prospering tree. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. God has blessed his people. You know, the world even knows that. In Kenya, Africa, my missionary friend there had a good friend. And that friend was a liberal Muslim. And they were the only non-Africans in that neighborhood. And they bordered each other, and so they watched out for each other, and they became real good friends. And I love that fellow. I've witnessed to him, give him literature and books. He's come heard me preach and all that, and I'm praying that old Toby will get saved by the grace of God. I really do. I love that guy. But there have been times when I've gone to Kenya and he's let us stay in his house. And man, he's got an enormous house. I mean, just a beautiful place. He just treats you like a king. And one time I went there and I said, Toby, what happened to that maid that you had? Everybody's got a maid over there. They don't pay them but just a little bit. But for the culture's sake, you got to have a maid and all that. And he said, said she had to go home to help her daddy, he's sick. I said, would you get your Muslim maid this time? He said, no way. He said, they'll beat you time. Said, they'll steal from you and they're dishonest. He said, I got me another one of them gals out of that Baptist church down there because I know they'll be honest and I know they'll do right and they'll be on time. And you know what he's telling me? He is telling me that God's children have a testimony and a witness that they're going to bring blessings with them. There are lost folk that want to hire Christian people because they know blessings. Everywhere Joseph went, God blessed them. Everywhere he went, you'll find out that God blesses his people. Amen. And whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. So we see the pleasures of the blessed man, the picture of the blessed man. But then look in verse number 4 at the punishment of the ungodly man. He said, the ungodly are not so. And they tell me that's in the triple negative. They are not so. It's a really big emphasis there. The ungodly are not so. They're not like the people of God. There's a distinguishment between the two. There is a difference between the ungodly and the righteous. Notice he describes them. He said, they're like the chaff which the wind driveth away. God's going to use some pictures. He said chaff. First time I ever seen chaff and wheat being separated. We were coming down through Petra, that rose red city in Jordan where many believe the Jews are going to hide out. And there was this lady that had beat some grain, and she was picking it up with her basket and pouring it out on her cloth, and the wind was blowing that chaff away, and the heavy wheat was falling down on that garment. And that was my first introduction to that. And God said the ungodly are like chaff on the wheat. It's going to be blown away one day. He has the fan in his hand, and they would take the fan in that threshing floor, and that light wheat would be blown away, never to be seen again. One day, the wheat and the tares is going to be separated, and all the chaff's going to be removed, and the winds of God's wrath's going to blow them away. And then the Bible says that they're not going to be able to stand in the judgment. Not only the chaff, but he talks about the court. In that day of the great court, when their name is called, they'll tremble before God, and they'll have no standing, and they'll have no state. And he'll hear God say, "Depart, you cursed, into everlasting fire. I never knew you." They'll not be able to stand in the judgment. I'll tell God how. You won't tell God nothing. You won't tell God anything. You'll tremble before a thrice holy God. And then the Bible tells us that there'll be no sinners in the congregation of the righteous. He talks about the chaff, the court, and then the picture of the congregation. Right now in our congregation, we have sinners set among us. We have people that come, and a lot of times they'll come just for the social aspect or for the fellowship of it. And you have lost kids come on the bus and they say, "Man, I love this because there's peace and people love me. I don't get that at home." But one day the congregation of God's people is going to be separated and the ungodly are be parted out of the congregation of God's children. And then in verse number 5, he said the conclusion is this: the way of the ungodly shall perish. That'll be their end. That'll be their way. But then look at the preservation of the godly. Verse 6, the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. The way of the ungodly shall perish. Praise God, I'm glad I know the way. And God knows the way of the righteous. And they're not going in the same direction of the ungodly that shall perish. But we're headed in another direction, and that direction is heaven. Hallelujah. Paradise of God, before the Lord's throne forever and forever and forever. The Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. He knows my name. He knows he saved me. He knoweth them that are his. And Timothy says he has set that seal upon those that are his. But the way of the ungodly, he'll say, "Depart, I never knew you." They'll abide in damnation forever. So, that's Psalms chapter number 1. Blessed is the man. And I hope in the days to come you'll chew on Psalms chapter number 1 and just let it be an encouragement and a blessing to you. And by the way, when the world tempts you and says, "Oh, come on out here, you know, there's something better," you go back to Psalms chapter number 1 and say, "No, there's nothing any better than being blessed of the Lord. I know what the way of the ungodly are going to go. But I also know the way of the righteous and how we'll end up." Hallelujah. Let's stand all over the house. Tell you what tonight let's do. I just want us to get in this altar and pray. And ask God to solidify what's been said in these messages and what God spoke to us. I want everybody here, if you can, if you can't, bow down, come sit on one of these front pews. I want everybody here. Let's get in this altar and let's have a congregational prayer tonight of communion with the Lord and seeking Him. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Coulter, you come too, son. Let's all get in this altar and seek the Lord's face together. Hallelujah. And Preacher Leroy, I want to thank God for you. I want to thank God for your stamina and your grit and just going on and preaching. And letting God handle the results of all this. Knowing the Lord sent you and giving you grit and grace and stamina. And I'm praying God will ever keep you encouraged and minister to you and bringing forth fruit in your season. Let's all pray together. You just open up where you're at and seek the Lord's face. Father, I want to thank you for this day. Thank you, God, for the opportunity to be in the house of God. And thank you, Lord, for letting us open the Word of God. Lord, just meditate and muse upon that Word that you've given us tonight. Lord, I do plead the blood of Jesus over every listener, somebody out there in the cyber world. God, I pray that this Word would get a hold of their heart, and Lord, that you might work in them by your grace and your mercy. Lord, I pray you bless your people. You know the burden of this church. You know the need of every person here. God, I plead the blood of Jesus and ask you to send them special blessings. And you said, blessed is the man. And you gave us direction on how to receive those blessings. And God, I pray in the days to come that there'd be an outpouring of the Spirit of God upon this church. And Lord, there'd be a divine drawing. I know folk witness and they invite. And I ask you, dear God, to break every stronghold of hell, every principality and power of the air. May it be defeated by the power of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And may you put a hedge about this place. And may God the Holy Ghost manifest himself. And may there be a divine unction and a drawing. Lord, give Brother Leroy liberty in the days to come to preach and to have your message. And God, I pray this Word would reach out of these building walls. And God, reach into the heart of souls out there in the cyber world and bring them here personally in the house of God. And then others, Lord, that are visited and prayed over again and again. God, I ask you to get a hold of them by your divine power, by your mercy, and by your grace, God. I plead the blood of Jesus, Lord. You know the warfare. You know the battles that all of us are in. God, I pray in Jesus' name that you'd help us to be strengthened with your might in the inner man. And may the divine grace of God just be outpoured in a special, a powerful, and a prevailing way. Lord, I commend these messages unto you with confidence that you said, my word would not return void. That's why you told me to preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. Lord, we know that your word is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. And I pray, Lord, that it would do that divine work that only you can give. Lord, we look to you now. We ask by your power and by your promise that you'll visit this place. You bless this people, God, in a special way. Thank you for your goodness to us now. We commend this meeting and we commend these messages. And Lord, we ask you to let us hear good news from a far country in the days ahead. Have your way now. God, I need your help. My wife needs your help. My family needs your help. Lord, our country needs your help. God, I pray that you would help us, Lord, by your mercies. Have your way now. We'll thank you for all you do in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Well, glory to God.
Amen. Thank you so much, preacher. Thank you for ministering to our hearts. I'm glad he did that. That's exactly what I felt like the Lord wanted. I'd already had it on my heart, and I thank God. I tell you, it's just amazing how God just, I'm sitting right there, and I'm going, well, as soon as he finishes, I'm going to ask us all to have altar prayer, and that God had already had it lined up, so thank God. You can't ever do it better than what way God does it. He knows what's best, always. Thank you, preacher, for preaching to our hearts all week long. Thank you. I hope you've gotten help. I have. And I know you have because you've already told me how God's helped you. Many of you have already come to me or else sent me a text this week. Thank the Lord for that. I can't tell you. I don't have the liberty to tell you the victories God's given in people's lives this week. I don't have that liberty. If God ever lets them stand up and say it, then I'll let them do it. But God has given victory throughout the week in a lot of people's lives. And I hope we stand by those decisions that we've made in our heart and where we've whatever it might be, just confess to God, Lord, I've erred in this area. It might be a minor area that a lot of people would think, but it was something in your heart that God said has come between me and you, and you need to get it right, and you did. And I appreciate that. But now let's pray that the Lord help us to stand on those things and not back up. Make promises unto God. You don't ever want to break those promises. We do at times, but we need to be quick to repent and get it right and try to stand by those things we've promised him. So, all hearts clear tonight. Did anybody have anything to say before we dismiss? All right, then. Brother Jim, if you would you dismiss us in a word of prayer? We're going to make our way to the back, and you make sure you let this man of God know you appreciate how he's been a blessing to your heart this week.